Good afternoon. My name is Aslam. I spent about 7 years in tech school. I retired 2 years ago. But under the current circumstance, with the new PhD, I can't retire. So that's why I'm coming here. I think the very big words that were mentioned this morning, sustainability, environment, ecosystem, and so on and so forth. I think before we start even talking about the big things, maybe I'd like to also hear, rather than walk the talk, let's hear the job talk individually from the panel members, what do they do personally in 2 minutes in terms of environment. I'll start with Azliza.
Technology, of course. Well, the first thing is I've got a plastic bag folded in my handbag, that's for sure, because wherever I go I can put things in it. And the second thing is I'm refusing straws. So hopefully, you know, with that, my son's bought me a metal straw for me to bring around. So
do students please write down so you know what else is
metal straw. Yeah. Besides that, it's of course talking to people about, you know, sustainability and educating people around food waste. So that's what we're doing right now.
Sorry, come back. On the consumer part, I must say I'm a little bit lacking, but I do a lot of waste separation. So the waste can be managed by streams.
That's right.
I'm actually redesigning my wardrobe. honestly. Because I think if you cannot change something which is external to you, which is your wardrobe, which is your clothing, very unlikely you will change something inside your wardrobe. So you need to start changing somewhere. You know, every day when you start changing the way you dress and the way you live, then you begin, you are very aware what is it that you need to change eventually.
Professor.
Thank you. Okay, I'll talk about individual level at home and also at the university. Okay, on my part, I think what I always preach and always, use the word nag to my kids and my husband is actually to actually practice, not 3R, at least 5R. The first one is always refuse. So, you know, refuse and don't buy unnecessary things, don't cook or overeat or overconsume. And I always also educate my maid to actually do waste separation at home. Yeah, so that because they have the 2+1 collection, so we do recycling and waste separation, and try to do composting. And most importantly, I think at the second home where we actually work, which is our second home, at the university, I head the eco-campus initiative. We have many projects. I myself have been doing the zero waste campaign in University Malaya, where we actually convert our food waste to become a compost and biogas. So we want to showcase and make everyone aware that actually, you know, there's a lot that we can do with waste and turn it into resource and not become a pollution problem.
So you hear some of the leaders in terms of recycling the waste that they have. I think this is something that all of us can do it if we have the right mindset. I've done it also in terms of composting, in terms of turning into agriculture and having separate waste bins. But I think there's one difference in terms of what we want to do and what about the community. Because I think from the background that we have, whether you are Malay, Chinese or Indian, we have the mindset that when guests come over to the house, we will always try to serve the best, and therefore we'll have excess food. That's something that we need to change as well. So we come back to the issues about food waste. But it is not something that is easy. It is something that we need to share with the older generation. I would say that probably Dato and Tan Sri maybe will probably in the older generation. What do you think, Tan Sri? Whether there is a big influence in terms of the culture and mindset of the past with what we have today? What's your comment on that?
One thing I want to separate is the question of value and the question of practice. many a times the old tradition is basically to give you a kind of a value. For example, when you come to the house, normally the drinks are very sweet, because to give you a value of sweetness, kind of, you know, how do you value? We give you a lot of food so that we demonstrate generosity. Yeah, those are the values that we need to retain. And that's a difficult thing. How do you then manage by telling you, well, we value you, we are generous to you, we are hospitable to you, but not in a demonstrative way that we finally will waste. I think this is a kind of mindset that we need to start thinking, where do we balance this? But I don't want to make it in such a way that you become very stingy, because you think you're going to save food, and therefore people don't come, you don't even serve a drink. I don't want to waste his water, and then you don't save anything, but you're not exhibiting to the right value. So a balance between value and how you demonstrate it is something that we need to start thinking how to best do it. And I think it is something that we need to explore, what is acceptable and what is not acceptable in this particular context.
Well, when guest comes to your house, probably it is, I would ask this question to the ladies rather than to two gentlemen, probably they know better than us. There is also the perception that if your guest come in, you would prepare the best cutlery and so on and so forth. What do you think if we prepare stuff using recyclable materials? Do you think that is acceptable? Or rather than plastic cups and all that? What was this? What do you think of that?
I usually pakai my own crockery lah, so can basuh yang pakai
garis lah.
Yes. Yeah. So I mean, I get your point. So, and being hospitable means it's probably not just the food, it's how you receive your guests, right? So sometimes even with water, people are really happy because you treat them correctly and welcome them to your homes. But yeah, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I'm quite happy to note that, you know, many venues now use glass, which is great because then they can actually wash and keep it back. So it's just how sometimes you think about convenience and you think about the future. So you've got to make that conscious decision.
Okay, if I can add, I think what Andrew said is great. Value you can retain, but I think that it should be a more holistic approach. Even if you have excess food waste, but if you know where to go with it, where to send it, then it's not an issue. So it's not just a matter of looking at what happens at the beginning, but to look at along the whole chain of events. So even like recyclables or plastics, if you know there is an off-taker, there is something to take it, there is somebody who will do right by it, then to a certain extent, you've done your responsibility. You are treating it responsibly.
I concur with the country about the culture and also the values that have been ingrained to us, because I had the first hand experience, my mom always complained that my drink is not sweet enough. and I personally, honestly, I don't drink sweet drinks. This morning I was served coffee, but it's too sweet, I couldn't swallow it. Just right there, I feel guilty. I just had to put it down because I always drink just plain water. We try to be, you know, we have to walk our talk first and foremost, and it's also for health reason. So, you know, we have been inculcated these values inculcated from us that in order for you to be a good host, especially for the ladies, you must prepare big spread, and especially your food, your drink must be very sweet. You know, if not, you're considered stingy. Ataupun tak pandai masak, tak pandai buat air, you know. So this is the mindset that we have to change. Yeah? So in terms of the culture, yes, it takes some time, but we need to actually, you know, slowly, you know, change the way we actually prepare our food and also serve people. Like for example, you can make that simple change by, like I say, if you eat out, don't go for buffet, go for a la carte. Just buy or eat what you can or what you want. And you share your food. Sometimes the portion is big, I share a plate with my kids. They all say, ibu jangan stingy. I say, it's not stingy. It's not about producing waste. And even if you produce, like for example at home, it's sometimes, you know, it's a bit difficult to change that habit, transcript. I tend to cook a lot of dishes when people come to my car. I like to, you know, there's always visitors and all that. But you don't throw away the food.
With technology, you have refrigerator. You can always pack it nicely and freeze it. And cook, eat it tomorrow or the day after. Okay? And if there's still leftover food, don't throw it to the dustbin. Put it in a separate bin and do your own compost. Simple as that. Then you can actually make that difference. So, you know, there's many ways of how you can actually contribute. You can go on and on, but I think I'll start with that.
For example, colour in honey sugar, then you separate, put the sugar separately. Then they can add, you know, how many tons of sugar they want. That is up to them. But don't force it on them. Yeah. But I want to add this question of bottled water. We cannot get away from bottled water because people serve bottled water. What I do normally is I will take the bottle home and I will drink the extra water. Don't leave it there because nobody is going to consume it. So people give you bottled water, yes, take the bottle home and consume the water. That's the best way to do it. Now, coffee, I've stopped coffee for 20 years now. I don't think coffee is necessary for our life. Who said coffee is necessary for? And I test this to my children. because we're addicted to coffee. Now, my children is this. We say we have got a regulation, nobody drinks coffee until they are age 12. Yeah? And by the time they're aged 12, I say, now you can drink coffee. And you know what's the response? I don't need coffee. In other words, we are induced to drink coffee. And that's why we stuck with it. And the same thing, the marketing thing. You know? So there are things that we can discipline ourselves to get away. Now we talk about Starbucks, coffee, 15 ringgit. And you think it's a lifestyle that you need to live with because the more expensive, the better the coffee is. But I can tell you, we don't need coffee. I've survived without 20 years now without coffee. So these are kind of decisions that we need to make. Nothing is forced onto us until we make the decision.
I think if I were to leave this mic with the four people over here, you won't go live for life. So maybe before I ask for the questions with any one of the four, may I hear anyone from the audience over here have any questions? Yes, sir. Can you please state your name?
Alright, so good afternoon. My name is Christian. So first of all, I would like to say thank you to all the guests for sharing very insightful information to us. So basically, I have a question, and it's regarding food consumption, in which you are consuming twice or thrice a day, every single day. So I have a question that in order for us to help to heal our Mother Earth, do you think that animal agriculture or consumption of meat is sustainable? Because as far as I've done my own research from a very reliable source, well, I found that approximately 33% of the Earth's ice free land is being used for this agriculture, and also around 1/3 of the world freshwater is also being used. Moreover, they are also responsible for 51 global greenhouse gas emissions, also responsible for 91% of the Amazon rainforest. Other than that, they are also recorded as the number one cause of disease, deaths, and species extinction, and many more. And also, it's been scientifically proven that it's not necessary for us to be healthy to eat meat. So what do you guys think? That's all. Thank you.
So, who'd like to answer this question?
I think I agree with what you say. Like I say, our lifestyle and also Malaysian culture is to eat. It's a favorite pastime in Malaysia. I mean, I have friends coming from overseas, they're shocked to see their 24-hour eating shops or restaurant in Malaysia. And their first question is, why do you have to eat until, you know, all the time? And it's become a norm, which is actually very unsustainable, very unhealthy. And I think we have to, for me, my principle of eating is actually the less you eat, the better. And of course, if you talk to the nutritionist, they say you have to have your three meals, but it's also looking at portions and what you take in or what you gorge in. You know, don't take nasi lemak and roti canai for your breakfast. An apple or a banana or oat drink is sufficient, or a date, you know, for example, with water. And for lunch, you can have something healthy. Let me just share with you my experience when I went to a conference in Japan for the first time.
in I think 1996. It was quite some time back. First time I went to Chiba, and it was an international conference. And as usual, you know, when you go to an international conference, what you expect to see, is, especially if you're in Malaysia, is spread, big spread of food being served for breakfast, for tea breaks, for lunch, and so on. But when I went to the university, no, it was a convention center, nothing, there was nothing. So when we registered, what we got was a coupon. So that, this shows that they have been practicing sustainability initiative, especially in terms of food waste, not to create food waste. So all participants were just given coupons. So if you want your drink, you just, there's a vending machine that you can actually just press and get your coffee if you want, or water. And for, there's no tea breaks, nothing, which is good. Actually, we don't really need tea breaks at 10 o'clock, we just ate our breakfast. And for lunch, we have to use a coupon. And surrounding, like for example, is like KLCC, you have a lot of shops and eating place. So surrounding the Chiba Convention Center, there are some shops, and you just look at the conference logo. So those shops that has got that conference logo, you can go in and use that coupon. And it's at a fixed price, for example, 10 ringgit meal. But if you want something extra, you fork out your own money. So it's good, you just take whatever is really necessary, and the organizers don't have to prepare food, don't have to waste food, don't have to cause environmental problems and pollution. Okay, so, and then he was talking about the resources. Very true, because a lot of the environmental resources are actually used for crop production, and then also for our meat production. And as you know, it's very true, eating meat actually is not very sustainable because you use up a lot of environmental resources. And on top of that, you know, the health effect and also the environmental pollution due to it. And agriculture, as you know, is also one of the biggest culprit in terms of water use and water pollution with the fertilizers and all that. So actually, it's a whole chain of things that we have to relook into how we actually govern our lives and our future generation. So we have to think of how to not only consume but produce more sustainably. Right?
I think that's right. The answer, from my point of view, I think is two-pronged. Firstly, I don't think we have to do without anything, but we have to be more responsible with what we choose. So, for example, if you had a manufacturer or a producer who was producing a responsible food, then there's no reason why you shouldn't partake in that particular kind of food. So, I think the bigger question is, how do you enforce that will to be more sustainable or to produce it more efficiently back to the manufacturer, back to the consumer? You see, because at the end of the day, there's no issue about consumption. I think we need consumption. It's the choice of consumption that we choose to partake in. So it's not about doing without certain things. It's, you have a, if there's an alternative, choose the right alternative. And if you choose the right alternative, that will shape a future market that everybody else then will comply and also become more sustainable. I think that's the way forward.
But before we go into further questions, maybe I'd like to ask a question as well to the panelists over here. I think we've heard about refusing, recycling, and sustainable consumption. Those are very nice words, very good words to hear. But at the same time, there is also the underlying issue that you might unintended consequence about shrinking the economy. Because if you're going to do all this, you stop doing all this, everybody in Malaysia, 30 million people, will start to prevent or refuse to buy certain things. Then you have the unintended consequence of economy shrunken, less development, and so on and so forth. And what do you guys think about that? Is that, is it something that is likely to happen? Maybe I'll start with Andrew.
I think to start off with, the frame of the economy is wrong. I've been challenging all the time, and just like Dr. say, this economy of growth is not sustainable. We cannot be growing all the time. Nature will tell you anything goes up must come down. The only thing I'll keep on saying, the only thing that grow and grow and grow and grow are cancer cells. What happened to cancer cells? They kill you and the host. So because we are framed on this, does that mean that you need to follow this? I need to go to the circular economy that you talked about. So there is more fundamental way of looking at how the economy needs to be organized. And therefore, then the sustainable, these are sometimes the frame of the question, sustainable consumption, is not a word that actually is compatible. So we talk about sustainability on a growth economy, I don't think it's sustainable. So we need to find a different model. And that different model is what we need to, your generation need to work on. I mean, the growth economy is basically the old economic thinking. Now we need to move into something which is new, and therefore this question becomes a pertinent question, you know, that we don't have to subscribe to the growth economy all the time because it is not necessary for sustainability. So that's where we need to start thinking, and that's where the university's role is. University do not just follow, the university needs to make the change, and where do you make the break and where do you make the change, that becomes our role, and that becomes an important role for the university.
That leads to the question about leadership.
Yes.
Because what Tansi is saying is about having the right model, but you need the right leadership to do it, and also the right commitment,
the right policy,
and so forth. So if you look along the same lines, if big leaders for big organizations commit to certain things, then it will make things happen. It doesn't mean that if you come up with a policy like what Prof mentioned just now, there was a policy from GBN. We were very closely to GBN. We didn't know there's such a policy. So I can understand from GBN as well, because if they're going to push hard on that, it might have an impact on the economy. Because if you look at, for example, one very recent event or policy, that changing of the color of a school shoe, you never thought there's going to be a reverse a problem behind it. So coming back to the situation on leadership, if big organizations would take the lead, I think it makes a big difference. So I'm from Tesco, it's just that I don't want to say it's Tesco's taking the lead, but this is something that we have been passionate about, not only today, but for the last 50, 60 years, because the policy in terms of climate change, we have a target up to 2030 to reduce it by 50%, and I think it's a policy that we need to be brave about and to push the agenda. So it is all about leadership and the commitment to do it. Now, can I ask other questions? Thank you, Christian.
Can I have any other answer?
Maybe I'll be someone else before I come back to you. Anyone else? Yes, over at the back.
Hello, my name is Ivan. I'm a professor of the Faculty of Applied Sciences. There are two issues I would like to raise. The first one is about conscious consumerism. I understand that conscious consumerism is marketed to consumers as a step of, like, you know, making us more conscious about our decisions. But there's a thing about conscious consumerism is that it makes people feel good rather than actually doing something. For example, with the ban of the plastic straws at Starbucks, everyone feels very happy, oh, now I can drink more Starbucks because, like, now they're doing, you know, they're being conscious about the environment, you know, that kind of thing. I feel like conscious consumerism is sort of like encouraging us to sort of consume more because we have the mentality that, oh, because they're doing something for the environment and I'm doing something for the environment, so I'll just stop that. So that is the first issue. The second issue is about distribution of food. I personally believe that consumption is not a problem, as the panel has discussed. It's about distribution. There are people who have a lot of food that produces waste, and there are people who have no food. They struggle to come, you know, to eat and to nourish themselves. So what are your opinions about these two issues? Thank you.
Let's listen to the theory, the answer of the theory first from the professor, and then from the practice is from Azliza. Ladies.
Okay, thank you for the question. There are two questions that you asked. And one about the sustainable, conscious consumerism. I think consciousness in everything is about being aware and being more responsible. Full stop. You know? So if we are trying to promote sustainable consumption, it's about, like I said, if you practice the basic principle of not 3R, but at least 5R, and it starts with refuse. Whatever you think is not necessary or has got certainly, definitely, everything that you do has got an impact on the environment. But how to minimize that impact? That's very important. Let's be conscious about your actions. Okay? So if you think that you want to actually play your part in terms of environmental conservation and consciousness, don't use things that are single use. The best is, like, for example, if you can walk instead of drive. I know it's not easy in this hot weather, because if you walk and if you cycle, you produce zero carbon for every kilometer. The next level is, if you want to actually be more conscious about your impact towards climate change, take a bus, take public transport. Because every kilometer travel using a bus is about, I think, 40 to 50 kilograms of CO2 per kilometer. Yeah, but if you drive, it's about almost 200. So you see, you can make that conscious decision if you really care about the environment. But of course, because of convenience, all of us drive. But if you don't want to take public transport, because our public transport is not very reliable in Malaysia, not very efficient, which the government has really got to do something about it, we are serious about our CO2 emission, then you at least carpool. Because I definitely, for one, I will never drive alone. I will actually, you know, before I go to a certain location for any events, I will make sure that I will ask around whoever is going the same direction, either I take a lead or I will invite them to come with me. At least I'm reducing my carbon footprint. Just of course, consumption is not about, it's just not just about food. It's everything that you do. Yeah? And then the second question was about the distribution. Yeah? The distribution. It's very true in terms of waste, food waste especially. For example, you know that we are blessed with a lot of eateries, restaurants, hotels, and they always produce so much food waste. Yeah? And I think the first thing that we have to target are these places. Because I always argue with the hotels, especially when we have functions or programs in hotels, they have this policy that you can't take back the food, which is to me so wrong and so sinful. So you can boycott these people, but I normally, when I have my functions or whatever activities, I will tell my staff, you pack back the food. I will demand from the places, please provide some plastic. They say, no, it's against our policy. I say, call your manager, because we paid for this and I don't want to create food waste. These are all good food. These are quality food, which if my staff or anybody else, or even the participants, are always in my function, tell my participants, please pack back all the food. So you prepare the plastic. But firstly, I think as an organizer, you have to be more prudent. Don't pack excessively. So if we can actually emulate the Japanese, we just give coupon, but people say you get a good luck, eh? What kind of a host? But okay, we cannot go to that extent, but we can actually just be prudent. Yeah? Just don't give excessive food. It's not good for the environment, not good for health. And if we want to actually reduce food waste, you can actually have, you know, like working with Tesco, and all these NGOs that actually collect food. There's so many in Kuala Lumpur itself. Food Aid Organization and Tencara and all that. You can actually engage with them and make sure that you don't waste your food. They will come and distribute, and they will actually give to the poor and needy. So there's a lot of things that you can do. And if you are also conscious about how you want to contribute in terms of your operation, you can actually install an anaerobic digester or small digester, food digester at home or in your office. Or do composting. It's so good for health. It becomes a community project. And with that compost, you're saving the environment. You can also produce your own compost, organic farm. So there's a lot of things that you can do in order for you to actually play your role. Yeah?
Right. Just to add on,
Yvonne, thanks for the question on distribution. I really hear you. Because actually, there's really not enough food out there. And the reason why we worked with Kachara, and specifically Kachara and Food Aid Foundation, because they know who their clients are. It's very difficult when we just work with one charity, but sometimes they come, sometimes they don't come, then you have another wastage, right? Because they collect, they cannot consume. But Food Aid and Kachara are really professionals. They identify who their charities are, they vet them, so they know that these are really genuine people. And they portion it out, and their logistics is really quite responsive, because we make sure that they deliver the same day. Yeah? So what we're urging, and I think the government is now listening to us, is the fact that food banks need to have infrastructure, which they don't. And when I said about the weather in Malaysia really does actually depreciate your quality of food, because food safety is very important, right, as well. So I think my question is, if you know of you know, eateries and stuff like that, do ask them to contact food banks, because I think that's the only way for us to ensure that food, whatever surplus. Now, I think hotels are doing a bit more of a more responsive listening, I would say. So, Sheraton has gone on board with Kachara, and therefore they are also saying, okay, fine, you've got buffets, and the ones that are at the back that are not, they will completely give it away. So, that's a change of mindset as well.
Share also with us, Lisa, in terms of consciousness on consumerism, particularly from the angle of supply chain, malls, and our end users.
Yeah.
And plus so, employees.
Okay. I mean, employees, we can do that very easily. I mean, I would say the most effective, because we see them every day. So from the, sometimes when we have our sort of seminars, we have twice a year, we have our own. So we say that today you need to bring your own cutleries, which we've already given you as a dog gift, so that you can actually use your own cutleries rather than using the disposable ones. And we try and sort of say that some of the meals that we create are from the surpluses that we save from the store, so they have an idea about what that is. And we encourage them to do the distribution process as well with our partners, so that they can feel it in their heart when they do it and they see they're needy. But with our mall tenants, we had a trial, something with pink energy, an aerobic sort of chamber which was installed in one of our stores, and all of the organic materials are taken in and put into that silo for them to sort of do a fertilizer. After a period of time, will be a liquid fertilizer that's come out. We are also working with another company called Entofeed. Yeah, it's French. But what they do is they have, yes, they've got worms, where the worms will consume all the organic sort of material from us, like wet chicken, you know, those kind of stuff. And it will create, the worms themselves will then be churned into animal feed, right? So that's one thing that we are effectively working on, so more tenants. And with, of course, the consumers, it's a bit tougher. You know, refusing plastic bags is also quite a challenge, because they can, one person, can you be this keluar barang, okay? Because we don't want to give a plastic bag to them. That's as bad as it is, you know? But again, when there is intervention, like in the northern states in Penang, nobody brings a plastic bag. I mean, nobody wants to take a plastic bag. They sometimes, if they forget, they just put everything in the trolley and cut it to their car and dump it all there. So it's all about mindset, and I think if we can, you know, when we use the children in the school, it's about creating that knowledge from young. And if they have tester power, so they tell their parents, hey, that's wrong, we're not going to do this. And therefore, they too can get influenced by it. So
I hope, Ivan, it answers your question. So, with regards to the two things that you mentioned about consumerism as well as distribution of food, so both of those penalties I've elaborated and given some good examples. So I'm coming back to Christian. If you want to ask a question, please just limit to a minute or so in terms of your question.
So is there any additional answer that any
sorry?
Is there any additional answers that any of the guests would like?
Any additional answers to this question?
If not, I will
stop. I see. Any? Okay.
Hi, Christian. You know, I remember you said about the production of food, which also goes waste from the agri part of it, right? The upstream production of food that can go to waste. I don't have an example from Malaysia, but I do have an example from our group in the UK. So what they've done is potato suppliers, when they supply to hypermarkets, there's a certain spec. So whatever they don't meet the spec gets discarded, because it's not, that's for waste. So what Tesco UK did was to actually go and find pre-packed food supplier who needs mashed potato and pair it back with that supplier, because you know that everything that this person needs doesn't have to look good. And there is also an initiative in the Czech Republic, I think our Central European, they call it the wonky vegetables. Yeah, so the vegetables look terrible, but they're normal, it's perfectly imperfect. Right? Perfectly imperfect. And people in Central Europe were quite, you know, amazed by this idea. Nothing is wrong with this vegetable, even if it looks bad. Yeah? So say, do your bit. They give you a green point incentive if you buy this vegetable. And so they do. So those are quite kind of innovative things that people are thinking of. to try and save food while it's in the supply chain. I know Marty does a lot on rice. They've managed to reduce by 90% the wastage on the upstream, but they're doing it slowly across all of the agricultural products.
So I suppose that very good questions coming from the floor, from the two students. Are there any more questions? Some burning questions in some of you guys here? No burning questions. Fantastic. Yes.
Bakar from Faculty of Business. It sounds like the waste is the culprit, you know, in the crux of our discussion. Just the question is, if we can have technology that can solve this waste issue, do you think we can retain our consumption pattern the way it is?
That's a very good question. Waste is not a problem. Mismanaged waste is a problem. Or unmanaged waste is a problem. Waste is a consequence of consumption or consumerism. To a certain extent, half that proposition is correct. So if you can manage waste well, can you still consume at the same rate? So from the management perspective, I would say yes. But from a consumption perspective, if you're still consuming finite resources, then it's unsustainable. If you are consuming partially recycled, or you have the circular economy concept of it coming in, then yes, your consumerism can be retained at a certain level. So it needs to be looked at holistically. So if a lot of your waste is recovered, reused, repurposed, recycled, then to a certain extent, consumerism can still be retained at those levels. I hope that answers the question.
Any comments?
I'm surprised that really wasn't able to comment, but I have a different perspective.
Okay.
It's very true. It's how you actually manage the outcome or the output of your activities. But again, we are talking about our finite resources here. Now, if we continue the trend and the unsustainable consumption and production pattern, you know what's going to happen. The dire consequences is going to come back to us in terms of pollution. Not only the pollution problem, but remember the finite resources. Because the definition of sustainable development is giving or producing, allowing your current generation to meet their needs without jeopardizing the future generation to meet their needs. So if you keep on squandering, using excessively the finite resources, how are our future generation going to meet their needs? What are they going to do? What are they going to eat? I mean, to a certain extent, the earth is already so stressed. Our resources, most of the non-renewable, are depleting. So are we expecting the future generation to just live on pills? But, you know, because food will be actually a challenge. Production will be a challenge because our land are all, you know, desertification is happening, water is not only polluted, but the scarcity of water, you know, and then the toxic materials accumulating in the environment. Can you imagine the future scenario of the future generation? So if we continue with our unsustainable consumption and production pattern, it is not going to actually be very beneficial for anyone. So I think we have to really relook and revamp our consumption patterns. And also, it has to go through the whole series of supply chain in terms of sustainable consumption. Like for example, we have to relook at actually using more non-renewable resources rather than our finite non-renewable resources. Yeah. So how to push for that? You know, for example, if you want to actually ask the government to be very proactive, especially because our biggest culprit is the energy use. What is the government, we hope the current government will take seriously the RE, the renewable energy policy. We have not moved very successfully as compared to our neighboring countries because we're not serious about it. Because why? Because we have Petronas and we are still so blessed with oil and gas that the tariff is still relatively cheap. Nobody wants to venture into RE because the upfront cost and also it's not very popular. But if it is made into the right framework and there's a, you know, correct incentive, we have the FIT, feed-in tariff and all that, but we don't really see the RE flourishing. So we cannot continue with our current pattern of consumption. You know, the resources is going to be depleted. We have to look at non-renewable resources. We have to cut down. We have to find ways and means to actually revamp our whole system of economic, because the current economy system, like Abby said by our chairperson, because unfortunately, if we cut down, then it's going to affect. Even the tukar kasut putih, tukar kasut hitam is going to has caused a lot of furor because we have not thought it properly about in terms of the economy's implication. But if you actually green the economy, because now people are talking about greening the economy, and how to green the economy, you make being environmentally sustainable profitable. Now our current economic system, the neoclassical economy, which actually pushes for GDP as an indicator for growth, is not sustainable because it is promoting using more, taking more from the environment, using more, producing more, but it's actually depleting and also causing pollution. So the whole system needs to be revamped. You have to make go green profitable. Because at the end of the day, sustainable development is not just about environmental consciousness and conservation, it is about social equity, it's also about economic development. And you can do it, but it needs a lot of effort, and it needs concerted effort, and it must be guided by the right policy framework. And like I said, political intervention, political will, and we need a lot of champions. We are all, I think, here, converted people. If not, you guys won't be here. Because you are concerned about the environment, or unless your lecturer threatens you lah, then you don't come, you don't get marks. But anyway, I think most of the time, you know, when I attend all these environmental sustainability agenda, I see almost the familiar faces. These are the committed people. We are concerned. We want to do something, yeah. But it's how to actually put our thoughts, our aspiration into real action. So in UCSI, you make the right move. You create this consciousness. Have your awareness week and all that, but it's not just about mere words. You have to really come up with proper framework systematically. How to push first before you make an impact to society, make an impact to the university. Because you are a student, you are a staff here. Make UCSI the first green university. Yeah, Mr. Leong is laughing. You can do it. So you have a proper framework. Have action plans. Have timelines, have outcomes, evaluation, monitoring, and so on. It has to be done systematically. It's not ad hoc. And caring for the environment, it must be done with conviction. If you just do it for glamour or whatever, it will not sustain.
Look at life cycle. I think that's important. I think the direction now is to look at life cycle, cost life cycle analysis, as opposed to just face costs. So you need to look at the overall holistic impact of it for all your decisions.
So I hope you guys... Sorry, I thought it's over. So you have to make it very, very short. We're running out of time.
I've got two short questions.
Go ahead. Would it be for lunch now or no?
So regarding the transportation, regarding how to hunt or reduce our carbon footprint towards the transportation, as I have done my research as well, I feel like, isn't that we need to solve problem from the bigger scale? As I just said that 59%, future is responsible for 59%, whereas all transportation only responsible for 11% only. So I feel like, isn't that we need to tackle the biggest problem at first, and then the small thing, which is not very effective. So what do you think of this? And then,
I think you can do whatever you can on whatever aspect. If you're smart about it, tackle the big problem. That's very true. Like I say, you know, in Malaysia, our biggest waste problem is actually food waste. But no one is actually looking at food waste separation. Even our ACTA Act 672, which is about separation at source, it doesn't tackle food waste. It's only about the recyclables. And recyclables, I tell you, is already done in the informal sector. It's already, even though it's not very systematic, but it's already done. But if we are strategic in our planning, we tackle the big problem, which is the food waste. If you handle your food waste or avoid food waste from going to the landfill site, you are actually solving 50% of your waste problem in Malaysia. The problem about waste and the disgusting landfill site or whatever, you know, some of you might have seen dumping ground, is because of the non-separation at source. If you can do separation at source first, yeah, you can actually separate food waste, but of course separating food waste alone is not good enough because it's already end of pipe. You should prevent food waste. So it's a long thing, right? So like I said, you know, you can target so many things, and you don't have, sometimes in your perspective, in your scope of area of your university or your activities, you can't tackle a certain area, but you can tackle the transportation aspect, for example. So it doesn't, you shouldn't stop yourself from doing whatever you can, because every single week makes a lot of difference. Yeah, of course transportation is not that much, but it still costs a lot of the greenhouse gas emission, and it's easily done. Sometimes you look at the low-hanging fruits. What is easier to be done first? There is a multi-pronged approach on how to actually look at environmental conservation.
I just want to add, resolution that doesn't mean that it's based on composition or percentage. Sometimes the journey for the resolution, like the low-hanging fruit, is simpler for the smaller fractions, because it can be, for example, resolved by a law or a regulation or a policy. Whereas if you're talking about social behavior, it's harder to enforce. So food waste, for example, is a bigger fraction, but a lot of it involves social behavior. And you can't put a law on social behavior, but it's easier to put a law on transportation. So sometimes the journey is different.
So I guess that comes to the end of this for sustainable consumption. Thank you very much to UCSI for taking the lead in terms of the forum. I guess I probably will ask the panelists again for just 30 seconds and tell the audience what would be the take home action they should or they like to do.
Well, for me, it's always the same, it's the refuse bit. That prophecy. Every time I see her, I remember the refuse. So, I mean, it's good for me because I really need to lose weight. But it is true, because what is the source of all evil for me?
30 seconds. Firstly, thank you very much for all those who stayed back, although not many of you asked questions. But it's encouraging to see that you stay back to hear more. My takeaway is, please be informed. Look for, knowledge, find out what the alternatives are, and then make the right decision that sits with you. Not everybody is going to be guided by the same decision. So go with what your gut says and do the right thing by what you think is the best.
My take home will be this. Please remember, Malaysia is a very blessed country. In terms of weather, in terms of calamities, in terms of food, yeah, but we have taken far too much for granted. So the moment you know that you are blessed, then you must know how to measure your action, so that the blessed will remain forever for the future generation. If you don't do it, then you will get the brunt of it. You may not, but your children, your children's children will do it. We are the best country in the world as well. No country can serve you 24-hour food. We do, yeah? But we have overused it, take it for granted, then it will not last forever. So keep this blessing and make sure we can survive for a longer period of time.
Okay, Prof, 30 seconds on
you. My last word, I always like to say this, remember what Mahatma Gandhi said, the world and its resources is enough for everyone's need, but not everyone's need. Okay, so I think that sums up everything. We really have to relook at our responsibility. Each and every one of us is responsible to take care of the environment, and we can do a lot of things, and together we make a lot of difference.
So let's give a warm applause to all the panelists.
Thank you.